By all accounts, 2020 was a miserable year, but interestingly, for television, it turned out to be quite a good one. Ad revenues declined, but the decline was smaller than in the previous year. And this medium continued to have and grow the lion's share of India's total advertising expenditure, or ad buy. Media agencies forecast that this trend is likely to continue this year. Now, according to BARC, total TV viewership was at an all-time high. You can see across several parameters that was true. But there was bad news as well. Last October, the Mumbai police said it is investigating the alleged rigging of the TV rating system by several channels, including Republic TV, Fakta Marathi and Box Cinema. Now, BARC, that's cooperating with the investigation, says it is business as usual despite this story. But is it really? And will TV sustain the momentum that it has experienced in 2020? Sunil Lulla, BARC CEO, is the man in the hot seat. Sunil, it's good to see you. Thank you for joining us. It has been quite literally for you the hot seat, isn't it?
I carry my own chair everywhere I go. It's never too hot for me.
That's wonderful to hear. Sunil, I'm glad to see that you're in fighting good cheer, because it must not have been easy these past few months. I know you have some very interesting data for us about the way 2020 panned out for television. But you know, before I go there, Sunil, I've got to ask you about the elephant in the room, and that is, why will anybody want to listen to any data coming out of BARC, given that there was this scandal that emerged in October, had highlights right up to January, and people are questioning the credibility of the data that BARC is putting out?
So the data is true, it's authentic, and it's trusted by hundreds and thousands of advertisers. It's about a 30,000 crore business in television, if I'm not mistaken. I see the data being used, being released every Thursday. I see it being used every day, because we get a lot of queries from various people, advertisers, agencies, and broadcasters of all color, shape, size, and hue. So I believe that the data still is and will always be true to what it says. It reports on what India watches. I think what we are reading about in the media, first of all, let me put this into context. It's something that's being investigated by various law enforcement agencies. Is something that's a matter listed in court and discussion in court. Anything I say on it is not appropriate and sub judice, and it's a matter of the past. BARC is continuously enhancing its processes, continuously augmenting everything that it does to ensure that the data it produces is authentic and reliable, and it continues to be so.
Right. Sunil, it is a matter that happened in the past. It very categorically happened before you came into the role that you're playing now. So that is on the record, and let's put it out there for our viewers. But the question remains about the credibility of BARC and its future existence, Sunil. So yes, of course, these are legal processes, investigative agencies, the judiciary is in the picture. So we're not going into the nitty-gritty of the details of the cases that have happened in the past. But we've got to look at the future. And where the future is concerned, Sunil, I want to know what you make of the fact that, you know, many people, including people in the government, are saying that there is a credibility crisis. Just a few weeks ago, Uday Shankar, till recently the man leading the leading broadcaster in this country, was on my show saying that it is time that we can measure the universe accurately. It's time to do that. It's just that certain vested interests may not be allowing it. Recently, just a few days ago, he spoke again saying that BARC is a letdown, that the processes, the systems of BARC are not really working. I mean, I can quote you if you want on exactly what he said.
So let me put this in context. The matter that you're referring to is about a few individuals. It's not about the company. The company has done nothing to change to take away from its processes or to take away from the applicable procedures. It's always depended on. There will always be, or there may be, few individuals who may have been errant, and that's what the law enforcement agency is looking into. It's not specifically looking into the measurement company known as Broadcast Audience Research Council of India. Having said that, there will always be individuals, and many of them whom I respect and know well, who will have a point of view. There is always a learning curve, and I'm very happy to learn from their advice. I can put together an equally illustrious list of names who have reposed their faith. As far as this company is concerned, its owners are the three stakeholders. And these three stakeholders across various meetings continue to reinforce their faith in the company. And these three stakeholders have their presence on our board, and they continue to have faith in what Bark does every day. All the process changes that we do, all the augmentation that we do, and all the innovations that we do have been greatly appreciated by our board and our stakeholders. So at the end of the day, I'm not going to respond to what is out there in the media. The fact is, each and every single day, advertisers, agencies, and broadcasters continue to benefit from the data that is produced by us.
Right. So Sunil, you're saying that this scandal and this kind of questions that have been asked on Bark's credibility has not affected the value of this medium and the kind of monetization what this medium can actually earn.
See, you need to appreciate that in the early part of the year of 2020, television viewing was at its peak. It's never seen that kind of viewing. The nature of time, average time spent went up by an hour from 3 hours 42 to 4 hours 48 minutes. People are watching TV 7 days a week. At a peak, that number went up by 110 million individuals watching television 7 days a week. It may have normalized now to last to 2019 level, yes, or a little higher than 2019. But the point is, there was faith in television. Even at a point of time when there was no original programming, people went back to see Ramayan because a large part of the younger generation missed it in the early 1980s. Ramayan, Mahabharata, the whole host of mythologies. They went on to see all the news and information that was there on COVID. And as soon as programming came back, they went on to consume that same programming. We saw such a turnaround in advertising volume.
I'm going to go through that, all those highlights of the year that was 2020, and you've got information out there that I want to see, and I know that television as a medium is relying on. But I just want to do, if you will humor me, a couple more questions, because these are questions people ask, and whether you like it or not, it's no longer an industry currency issue. Yes, the industry is backing it, but it has spilled over into the public domain, because people have been are questioning or are interested at least in how this currency works, okay? And there are advertisers who have spoken up. The question I'm asking, Sunil, is that we are talking about the news genre, which is about 2,500-3,000 crore rupees in value in terms of its share of the overall television ad revenue or spend, which is between 25,000-30,000 crore rupees or in that region. So if it's possible for us to have corrupt practices or manipulation, in such a small genre, then why should we believe that everything is kosher in entertainment and sports where the stakes are so much higher?
See, I'm going to stop you here because I think there are no corrupt practices. If there are practices which are outside my domain, I have outside the domain of Bark, then I don't think we have jurisdiction on that to make any comment. As far as Bark goes, our processes are secure. Our processes are secure. Like I said, this matter is under investigation. It's not fair for us to comment about these issues over here at this point of time. Advertisers will make the choices they have to make. I have spent some time through the auspices of the Indian Society of Advertisers, talking to the ISA Executive Committee and to many of its members, and they were very clear. Television is and will continue to be the most effective means to reach the masses in India, mm-hmm, to reach the homes of India. It will always be the screen of the household. Let us understand that there are only 200 million homes by last count which have a TV set. There are at least 100 million homes which are yet to get television. And it will always be an aspiration for everyone to have a TV in their house. It's the most cost-effective way to get information and entertainment, and it's something that the family enjoys viewing together. And let's cherish that, and let's appreciate. At the end of the day, what television and the advertising on television does is it stirs up demand, it stirs up consumption, that drives the economy. And that is why it's so very important.
Sunil, the case you make for television is clear, loud and clear. So there's no existential dilemma or crisis at all, at least where this medium is concerned. And that's clear and will be clear to viewers with the data that you will present to us as we go forward. But what about the future of BARC? Are you saying that BARC is not on the brink of an existential crisis? When you hear, for instance, the INB Minister Prakash Javadekar talking about the Vempati Committee report and saying the government reserves the right to give guidelines and direction, those shall be given in time, but the report having come today is a big step. You know, when you hear these kind of statements...
I have to stop you here because your reading is out of context. First of all, we all know that BARC operates as a Section 8 company. It's owned by three stakeholders. Mm-hmm. It applied for the license from the MIB and has obtained a license from the MIB and continues to operate under the purview of that license and operates effectively. The committee that was set up by the MIB was because it was in 2008 that the committee was set up to issue guidelines, which was called the Amit Mittal Committee. And this came into force many years later. And thus, BARC was created for the good of the industry, for the stakeholders. I think the government recognizes and has been very clear that there's always a need for a stakeholder body to work together. If there may have been aberrations in the past, then those aberrations need to be worked on, and that's exactly what's happened. And our board is well aware of all the process changes we have undertaken to ensure we remain secure, true, and faithful to what India watches. There is no such crisis for BARC. There will be individuals who won't believe. There may be associations who believe or don't believe. I get a large volume of email, phone calls, and letters from people asking us to continue the data and to continue doing many other things. So I think at the end of the day, yes, there will be some critique, there will be some criticism, but I think the fact that the data is being used every day tells you that. The fact that we will be doing a new BI, we couldn't do one last year, our Broadcast India survey, which tells you how many homes have a TV set, our estimation. We couldn't do it last year because of COVID. We are going to continue to invest on it. This is an ongoing organization. This was created for one purpose, for the purpose of advertisers, agencies, and broadcasters to have a common currency and to have a common medium. So at the end of the day, the stakeholders had to sit down together and to then internalize or to introspect on what issues they may want to address. And at this point of time, we've addressed the issues that we need to address.
Right. So you're absolutely clear at this point of time that BARC will continue to be relevant and will do what it is meant to do, which is create absolutely reliable data to measure the television industry and how this medium is functioning.
101%.
You already talked about the kind of exceptional viewership parameters, yes, that came out last year. Do you see that trend continuing into this year, 2021?
No, we must understand the reason for that viewing. You know, there was an unprecedented lockdown. If in such a nature of lockdown, which has never been seen before, barring a few stray buns that used to happen many years ago. In unprecedented lockdown, you're at home for many days. Your only window to the world is that wonderful equipment that's in a corner, that's a TV set, and is getting information from all over the world in whichever language you wish to consume. And be it news about COVID, be it our Prime Minister's messages, be it government notifications, be it advertisements, be it entertainment, all kinds of things that people had to watch. So what was the trigger for the viewing? When people weren't going to work, school, college, or, you know, traveling, what we call non-prime time, which is from early morning 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., was where TV viewing really grew. People were sitting hours and watching television because they were at home. They couldn't go anywhere. They couldn't shop in that time except for a little bit of online that was permissible for essential goods. There wasn't much supply chain working, if you remember, in the late part of March all the way till May. So we saw that.
Right.
Over a period of time, as you know, shooting started, original programming came back, we saw news which went from 7% of viewing of all TV to 14 to 21.
Yeah.
Is back at between 7 and 8%.
Yeah.
It changes weekly, is roughly back that where it is. So TV viewing is now similar to what it was in 2020 and what it was in 2019, right? So at this point of time, that is still a humongous number. It's still very big.
Sure. Let's talk about the IPL, because really that was the fact that the IPL could be staged and was staged in the way that Star TV managed, Star Disney managed. That really was what gave the momentum to TV, isn't it, as a whole in the second half of the year?
So it played, I think, first of all, it played a big sentiment driver role. The fact that, you know, IPL was back is a good season. It was good news. Advertisers flocked to it. Viewers flocked to it. We saw growth in viewing. We saw increase in viewing. Once again, the opening match, Mumbai versus Chennai, was the most watched match at 11.2 billion viewing minutes. So you know that cricket does that, right? It's one of the biggest passions of India. And IPL is so to speak, the king of that passion.
Would it have been a completely different picture if the IPL hadn't been staged in terms of television's performance in that incredibly challenging year of 2020?
I think advertising volumes would have suffered a fair bit. IPL hadn't happened. I think people would have moved away, gone to other mediums to advertise. So, you know, those who had the money to advertise on IPL, use IPL. Otherwise, they would have to arbitrage their money across other genres. Viewing as such, I think, would have still been the same on an overall basis. Because there's always a peak viewing that happens in IPL because it brings in some of the younger viewers. Hmm. So to that extent, yes. But I would say at a significant level, IPL is a very big sentiment draw, and that's what it does. One of the notable things actually about IPL not happening in the usual fashion was out-of-home viewing, which is also good for IPL, of course, couldn't take place because you couldn't go to a restaurant or a pub, right? Yeah. And that is also a notable part of the viewing. And I'm hoping that with time to come, as we learn to deal with COVID and we ensure safe precautions, that some of that returns.
Okay, a quick word about the advertisers. It's interesting to see that the top 10 advertisers in terms of single corporate entities are all from the FMCG sector. And it's also interesting to see that Amul doesn't figure in that list at all, though it got quite a lot of buzz and word of mouth in the way it advertised, especially the early on in the lockdown last year.
Yeah. Amul, because the essential product could supply, right? It's milk and butter and ghee and cheese, etc. So it got that inroad in, and I think they made a bold move playing it up there, an appropriate move. So what is interesting is if you just look at the top 10 categories and top 10 sectors of 20 versus 19, 2020 versus, there is growth. There is growth in the top 10 sectors. There is growth in the top 10 categories. There's growth in the top 10 advertisers. The mix has changed a little bit, just marginally so. Or the rank order of the top 10 advertisers may have changed. But it's broadly speaking, there is growth, which means the top 10 advertisers, top 10 categories continue to invest in television. And that's what TV is all about. It is consistent, it's enduring, it's the most effective way to get to people.
Talking about advertisers, government volume ad spend went up quite a bit, isn't it? The volume of government ad spend went up quite a bit, isn't it, in 2020?
Yes, it did, especially during the COVID period, because there was a lot of messaging that the government was doing about, you know, washing hands, sanitization, wearing a mask, being careful, not gathering in crowds. So because of that, we saw a lot of change in government advertising. It really peaked up during that period and has remained amongst us higher. It's remained higher in 2020 over 2019.
Right. A quick question on Doordarshan and the revival of the old mythological series, which you talked about right at the beginning. Is there anything there? What kind of, how do we see this performance, them being able to, sort of gain traction from what they did last year?
So I think a master move, first of all. Okay, and Mr. Vempati deserves all the credit for that decision that he took to bring back Ramayana and Mahabharata. The same people who may have uttered other things to you, Anuradha, uttered things saying that, you know, who will watch this? But what an amazing performance. I mean, the viewing of Ramayana beat the viewing of Game of Thrones at a global level. It was the world's number one watch show of 2020, right? So, and it's all about people who are at home together, many who had missed that, who weren't there when Ramayana first telecast, if I'm not mistaken, 1986, and then caught up with it. And the big advantage of it was that we saw ad volumes grow on Doordarshan. It was a 2% growth in Jan-March, went up to 62% growth in April-June when Mahabharata and Ramayana were on Prasar Bharati channels. And it continued to sustain. July-September over last year grew by 41%, October-December. So overall, Doordarshan benefited by bringing these mythologies back and bringing confidence back. They are the public broadcaster. Their purpose is very different from private broadcasters. But it brought back the faith of advertisers.
And I think it sort of gives you a sense of really how large and vast the Indian television viewing audience is, isn't it? And how tiny the slivers are that we probably represent in our viewing habits. But Sunil, you know, when in October the Mumbai police revealed that it was investigating the case and all of that, you all suspended, BARC suspended news, the ratings for the news genre for 3 months. 3 months are done. Are you all ready to start the ratings again? And when do we see news genre ratings coming back?
So first of all, our suspension of the data has got nothing to do with what was happening with the police. BARC suspended the release of individual news channel data, which is channel-wise. So in your case, CNBC. The genre data continues to be available. We continue to collect all the data. We did this on the request of our three stakeholders, the advertisers, the agencies, and the broadcasters, who believe we should revisit the format of reporting this data. In this category, there's a lot of competition. We report on more than 180 channels, and there are maybe 30 odd news channels which don't subscribe to BARC. So there are more than 200 news channels, but 180 that we report on. It's hyper-competitive category, and there's a way to address it. And therefore, under the auspices of our technical committee, also as you may be familiar, it's called TechCom. Through our TechCom, that we've been through a process. We have now understood how we want to report. Our TechCom has approved the process that we want going further. It will go up to our board for approval. The matters with the stakeholders, when the stakeholders are ready and aligned, we will roll the data.
I can tell you that the lack of ratings has actually been welcomed by certain advertisers. It has been welcomed definitely by professionals in newsrooms and perhaps even the viewers, because a sense of sanity, and a sort of easing of pressure has happened because these ratings have been suspended. Is there a thought there?
If I may be permitted to just reflect differently, the purposes of the rating or the audience measurement system and the audience estimates we give is for advertisers to make decisions on audiences. Now, no advertiser makes a decision based on how Thursday versus Friday works. They make the decision over a periodicity of 4 weeks, 13 weeks, and those kind of durations. It is a little unfortunate sometimes that individual broadcasters may leverage certain peak performances within a day or within a week to show out how strong they are or, you know, speak about their performance. But as all advertisers and agencies will tell you, you need a fair run of 4 weeks at least, ideally 13 weeks to really make those decisions. And somebody may have the highest audience, but may also have the highest price. And therefore, an advertiser may not be able to afford that. And somebody may have a lower audience, but have a reasonable price, and advertiser could afford that. So there are multiple things here at play. I think at the end of the day, advertisers are smart. They know what to choose. They have reliable agencies to advise them, and they have the ears to their ground through their field force and through other such cohorts. So they're able to understand what their audiences, whom they are interested in, are watching.
Right.
Well, if you're using it to split hairs about, you know, who did better at 9 p.m. or some other time slot over there, I would say that's not the right way to use the data, and we have enough on our website on that subject.
Right. Sunil, you know, there was a reason why the three stakeholders that make up this media landscape got together and formed BARC. It was relevant. It definitely is relevant. The question is, was the corruption that has happened in the past, or attempts to corruption that have happened in the past, has that undone what this was meant to do? And I think that question, Sunil, is not for you. It is for your board, and it is for all the stakeholders who have got together to create BARC. Because
let me respond, because I discussed this with the board. And let me tell you, the board continues to believe and back BARC unequivocally. They have 100% faith in it. They understand what we do. They understand the processes. They understand the incidents that may have taken place, and they fully reimpose their faith in Bach.
Right. Well, that's good to hear. And Sunil, maybe soon we will know how things progress on the things that happen, and we will meet you again for a fresh set of data on what India is watching. Thank you very much for joining us. All good luck.
Stay safe, stay healthy.